I'm Scott Plucek from the University of Alabama at Birmingham, and I'm actually hoping that there will be a decided lack of moderation at this session altogether. As Della said, the idea for the session came about from a conversation at Charleston, in which I was talking about some of the work that we've done through the Chicago Collaborative to try to create venues where people in publishing and people in libraries have a chance for real conversation. We've done some sessions through the Chicago Collaborative where, as librarians, we have tried to do presentations to publishers about what we think y'all are interested in, and it turns out that the Q&A to those sessions is a lot more interesting than the presentations we were going to do. So, on the assumption that it's the Q&A that is the most fun part of a presentation anyway, we're just going to do the Q&A. All right? I'm going to ask my colleagues to introduce themselves here in a second, but I'm serious about this as Q&A. If this is going to work, you all have to really be a part of it. So you've all gotten copies of these sample questions that we put out, and this is something that Della and Janice and I kind of put together based on our interactions with people about things that we think people in publishing are interested in, that we know that librarians are concerned about, but by no means are you restricted to asking questions about these topics. This is really just to get you thinking. We are all in this tremendously transitional space where what librarians do and what we think our responsibilities to our communities are changing radically. You all are going through the same thing. Our partnership, even though it sometimes seems strained, particularly over the course of the last decade, our partnership is absolutely essential to everything that we do. So I feel that it is more important now than ever that we really establish a good, strong dialogue. So I hope that you're all up for this. I'm going to ask each of the four up here to say a couple of words about who they are and where they're from and maybe what they expect to have happen, and I'll start down on the end there.
I'm Ivy Anderson from the California Digital Library. I know a number of you in the audience, but many who I don't know, so it's a pleasure to be here and have this chance to talk with you all. At the California Digital Library, my role is to direct our shared collections program. For those of you who aren't familiar with the California Digital Library, we're a unit of the University of California system. We're created a little over a decade ago to help facilitate and support the transition to digital information at the University of California. We have a broad range of initiatives, including not only licensing digital content, but also working with data curation and other forms of preservation and curation. We have a repository and publishing program, which is quite vibrant. And so I work with the shared collection initiatives in an organization that is a great and exciting place to be.
Okay, I'm Jill Emery. I'm the collection development librarian at Portland State University. Portland State is a public urban university in the northern part of the city of Portland. We have a collaboration with the Oregon Health Science University, which is the teaching hospital in the city. We are also a member of the Orbis Cascade Alliance, which is an alliance or consortia of 37 libraries, academic libraries in the Pacific Northwest. In addition to this, I'm a past president of the North American Serials Interest Group, and I'm heavily involved with the Electronic Resources and Libraries group as well.
I'm Steve Gass. I work in the MIT libraries. In the libraries, basically, we try to support the mission of MIT, which is to educate students, to help solve the real problems, do research, and bring that research and make it available so others can use it and share it and apply it to trying to solve the challenges that we all face in society. And we're very much committed to lowering the barriers associated with access to content that helps people do meaningful things for the world.
And I'm Lorraine Harricombe. I'm dean of the KU Libraries. KU Libraries, it's the University of KU, not Kentucky. We in the heartland, we're almost right in the middle of the country. And we are a large research university. We don't belong to any consortium in Kansas. There is none such. And we do everything that Steve has just articulated here as a research library. My role is to oversee the entire library system, which consists of 8 facilities on the main campus, as well as in Overland Park, which is closer to Kansas City. The university has a medical school as well in Kansas City with its own library. It does not report to me, so we have 2 large main campuses in that way, if you will. We are a leader in the area of open access. University of Kansas was the first public institution with a faculty-led open access policy. It was approved in 2009 and again in 2010, and I serve as the provost designate for open access implementation on campus.
All right. So there you have it. And we've got a couple of people with microphones, and I see we have a question already. Very good.
Gary Vanavis, American Psychological Association. I'm interested in online identity, and I'm interested in how it relates to authentication and access rights to material. And I'd like to hear anything about what universities are doing to make the identity of their users who are affiliated and are authorized users of their campus assets, helping them to be able to take those rights with them when they're not on campus, when they're on the road, when they're traveling around the world?
Well, normally what most universities strive to have a single sign-on for pretty much all their user services at this point, so that they don't have to have multiple accounts that they're managing. With the single sign-on, then that is kind of their library credentials in addition to being their university credentials. And they use that to access resources using a proxy service. The one proxy service that I think the majority of us probably use is EasyProxy, which used to be a standalone product, but it's in the past 2 to 3 years became part of the OCLC suite, the services that are being offered. And basically, we set up resources within the proxy, and the user, when they hit that resource coming through our portal and they're off campus, they're asked for their login at that point, and they authenticate. And once they do that, they should be authenticated for the length of their session to any of the resources that the library makes available to them.
Yeah, our system is pretty similar. It's probably similar across the table here. I just want to add something else. In addition to bona fide faculty and students who are there currently, that's true for retirees as well. They continue to have access. And in on campus, we have criteria whereby which if there's a visiting scholar, for example, for shorter periods of time, will have similar benefits until they leave.
Yeah, I think the my observation is that some of the definitions of those populations shift somewhat by institution. Whereas some institutions will include alums, retirees, as you say. What I find interesting coming from an academic medical center campus, and what is more challenging is because of the nature of the work groups, we have odd arrangements of who has access and who doesn't. Typical example, UAB has a branch campus in Tuscaloosa, where they play football. They have a university. and at that branch campus, the way that the UA system is set up is the University of Alabama, University of Alabama at Birmingham, where I work, and University of Alabama Huntsville, all of which operate quasi-independently. The medical students in Tuscaloosa are UAB students. So they're included under all of my licenses. We use EasyProxy. They can get at everything. Their faculty members are faculty of the University of Alabama College of Community Health Sciences, so they are not my faculty. So I can't provide the same licensed resources to them that I provide to their students. And I think it was alluded to this morning, and it's one of the issues that we put on the sheet, that this is becoming more complicated for all of us as we have all of these increasingly complicated relationships where you have people who are working together, but because their home institution may have different licenses, we can't provide the same set of resources. And that's something that is going to require, again, I think, work with the publishing community to sort of rethink how we handle some of those licenses to deal with it.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree that most of our institutions have quite highly developed and robust systems and services for remote access to authorized users. And so that's really not the problem. The problem is the burgeoning collaborations across institutions of various sorts that are creating that equity of access problem. On the authentication side, I would just add that we're trying to move to Shibboleth authentication for a lot of services on campus, and we expect that we will use Shibboleth eventually with online resources as well, although that's a fairly complicated move, and so we're not quite there yet. But I think that's another authentication technology that will allow more independence of location and movement. But it's really the collaborations across institutions and including in some cases with industry or other kinds of nonprofits that are presenting more of an access problem.
Becca.
Fred Dillo, American Institute of Physics. Shift topics a minute, back to open access. I see it on your list there. And many librarians, including some of you, have been very effective spokespersons for open access and promoting it. I'm a physicist, so I'm going to ask you to do a thought experiment. Suppose we could wave a magic wand and change the entire corpus of the 25,000 titles out there from subscription to open access. It's a two-part question. Would you want that to happen? And secondly, what do you think happens to your jobs for the component of your jobs having to do with paying for and disseminating and dealing with journals?
Can I ask one clarifying question as one of the assumptions of your thought experiment? In this transition, is everything being adequately paid for at some level in this open access world?
Yes, I'm assuming that we go from 90% subscription, 10% author pays, to 100% author pays.
Okay, and that's all working, and so the question is, what does it mean for us?
That's right, and one way that model works is that money goes from your budgets to your research provosts, right? So you can continue the thought experiment.
So I'll jump in on that one, because I would say the answer to the first question is yes. I work at an institution whose faculty are very engaged in the open access debates and are working now on advancing open access in a number of ways, and have formally asked the president of the University of California through his designated organizations like mine to work proactively to advance open access. So my institution wants me to be there, and so that's where I want to be. I think the second part of your question is a really interesting one on a number of levels. I know a number of faculty at my own institution who think, well, then the library just no longer has to be a part of the equation. And I think it is much more complicated than that. I think institutional resources should still be part of the funding of open access. If we transition to that model, it shouldn't just be coming from external organizations. I don't think it can be just coming from external organizations or from an author's pocket. But I think more than the financial role, there's an institutional stake in many aspects of the enterprise in ensuring persistence and ensuring adequate access, ensuring good editorial processes and so forth. And I think the institution stake is a longer term one than the stake of any individual author or researcher who wants access to content. The institution is the one that says, particularly the institution's library, is the organization that says persistence of this information over time is what's important to the long-term health of the enterprise, and we have a role in that. And so I think our challenge in that transition is figuring out what parts of that do we continue to have a role in, and how do we exercise that role in an open access world. And it's a valid question, because not everyone understands and agrees with how those roles might shift and how the stakes might be preserved.
I would agree with what Ivy said, and also say, I mean, our research offices are willing to help support the grant procurement that is needed to support open access, but they're not there with tracking the publications and the publishing. And there's still going to be a role on campus for someone to do that, and I think that's going to fall to the library. And I think it's already falling to the library, and we are all trying to find ways to understand where our faculty are publishing and to map that out and to figure out how to put things that are currently in the for-fee world, capture what we can to go into our institutional repositories, and in a completely open access world, we would still want to be able to track that, as Ivy has indicated, to preserve it and to make sure there are preservation mechanisms in place so that that scholarship is there for the long term.
I would also say yes, I would love to see a totally open access world. I think all of us are committed to reducing barriers associated with access to information that advanced teaching, learning, and research at all the institutions we work at. And that would be a very significant barrier that would dissolve. I agree in terms of how we sort out the roles going forward and work together to ensure proper preservation and stewardship of these important assets going forward is unresolved. And we just also suggest there's a lot of other roles the libraries play on campuses that are still going to remain in terms of providing research support, instructional support, and providing rich spaces for collaboration and learning and study. So while it would be a great opportunity for all campuses to think very seriously about how they can best reallocate resources within the library to other functions, whether they be in the library or other associated functions, I think we would all, I would welcome, you know, that future.
I don't really have anything new to add to what was already said, you being fourth on the panel here, but I think you touched on the instructional role also of the future faculty, you know, the graduate students who are there now who are not so familiar with this environment. It's a rich market for us. We personally, I've had that experience on our own campus right now as I'm speaking, for example. But I think the key message here is, the first one is, yes, of course, we believe in content, intellectual content as a public good. And preservation is our mission. I mean, there's nobody on campus who does preservation like librarians know how to do it, and I think we ought to have that as a priority in an open access world.
Yeah, I'll echo some things, but just for fun, I'll disagree slightly with my colleagues. Again, to the first part of the question, everything being open, yeah, I think that is a desirable goal. How we get there in a way that doesn't have serious unintended consequences, I think, is very much the question that we're facing. In terms of roles, certainly what I spend much more of my time instructing my staff and driving my staff is towards the training and support. The great thing about the world that we're in now is that the wealth of available information resources has expanded so tremendously. And it's hard when you're sitting in the middle of it to realize just how dramatically different things are from 15 or 20 years ago. But it makes it a lot more complicated to be a student, to be a researcher, to be a clinician, to actually be able to make your way through all of this stuff effectively. I like to use a quote from the writer Nicholas Carr, who says that the finding problem, the filtering problem, used to be trying to find a needle in a haystack. And the problem we have now is that we have haystack-sized piles of needles. And that's a fundamentally different problem, and it's one that we don't have the right tools to solve. So I think that, as a role for librarians, is going to continue to be strong. Where I differ somewhat with some of my colleagues is, what is the appropriate role for institutional repositories? I'm not fond of the notion of using institutional repositories to store published material, because I worry about stewardship and I worry about versioning. On the other hand, institutional repositories to make available born digital material that would never get into the formal publishing stream, I think represents a really great opportunity, and one that libraries are well positioned to take advantage of.
All
Just to follow up on something Scott said, I think the realm of personal information management is like, wow, is where the intersection between your personal information and the published world of information and tools, as we heard this morning, like Mendeley, which, you know, are trying to really help people deal with in that space and kind of extend your ability to, you know, to just manage all that, as well as, you know, put a brand new twist on the whole kind of idea of the invisible college, and how you share information and work with your peers. In that space, I would agree with Scott that there's a huge role for librarians to be very productive in working with the communities, because we know a lot about information management and what it takes to organize it and be able to use it effectively.
It's something else that reminds me of when you're talking about personal management. I had a conversation with a department chair in Health Services Administration the other day, and he brought up two things, one of which is his feeling that his faculty are not getting sufficient training in how to use this stuff, and he really needs that. But the other thing that he mentioned is that increasingly on our campuses, when we talk about data management, we have a tendency to think about it in terms of the data that our researchers are generating. But in his area, they purchase a lot of data sets. And those tend to be purchased by a particular research group for a particular purpose. They get stored locally. It's not real clear what all has been purchased at an institution and who has access to it and under what circumstances. And his question to me was, we need some librarians to help us get a handle on all of this. And I think we're going to continue to find those not just as opportunities for librarians, but as our institutions really coming to us and say, we need you to help us solve these problems.
Well, I think since you touched on data management, also individual researchers, not just groups, but individual researchers who drive around with servers in their cars and go to Best Buy to buy what they need for storing their data, except there's no clue on the campuses as a whole as to how many sets and whose sets. There's no programmatic, systematic way to inventory, even to know and understand what that is. And that's a space, I think, that librarians can step into. On our campus, I know some schools are further ahead in this than others, but I think most are probably where we are in terms of just starting and identifying who those researchers are, because they're beginning to look to the librarians and to the CIOs for help. And it's, I think it's an area where we can provide support.
Yeah, I would echo that. We're just starting a plan, a data management plan, working with our Office of Institutional Technology and our research and sponsored projects. So the minute basically a grant is given that will require any sort of data or data management, that the librarians involved at the very beginning to help set up the metadata that will be used, it'll then go to our information technology department for the setup of while it's in production, and then it'll come back to the library for some sort of preservation. So we're like starting to outline and lay out the plans of how we'll deal with the data issues.
I think the data issue illustrates some of the changes that are happening in libraries as well in terms of where and how we engage in the research process of scholars and researchers, where in the past libraries collected information after it was formally published, and that's where the curation and stewardship role began. And in the data environment, what we're increasingly understanding is that how data is managed from the moment it's created is very important to its long-term stewardship. So not everything that someone creates or that research groups create is going to need to persist. And it's hard to know on the front end what will need to be managed over the long term and what won't. But what we are learning is that if it's not well managed at the beginning, then managing it later on when that becomes important is very, very hard. And so we're finding that role of engaging with the stewardship requirements of the information that our researchers are producing is happening in a much earlier process, and that's where libraries are beginning to have more of a role.
Yeah, we've been approached by our graduate school and the computer science department to work on helping to develop some training modules for all of the PhD students and postdocs on how to manage your data properly from the very beginning. And this was pushed partly by a guy in computer science who, because of what he described as a series of poor decisions on the part of a couple of grad students, resulted in the loss of 20 years worth of data, which he was going to be able to recover at a cost of about $20,000. So that's a real practical need to get people thinking much more systematically. And I know, I think MIT has done some really good stuff in training, developing training materials for dealing with data management up front. But if the thing that I find fascinating about this whole topic is that if you look at that whole life cycle of data, from its creation to its use, to making sure it's validated, to then thinking about what does need to be preserved for the long term, who's going to do that, how do you make it available, how do you preserve it, there are entities within the modern research university that are very interested in one little slice of that whole data life cycle. But there isn't really any single entity that clearly has responsibility for the whole thing. So what we're seeing happen in institutions is these really interesting partnerships between the library and the research people and IT to come up with these sort of quasi-organizations within the institution to try to touch on all of these things. And then ultimately, of course, that impacts how all of that data connects to what eventually does get published in some formal sense.
Right.
And one of the challenges associated with this emergence of data and what to do with all the data is, how do you pay, you know, for whatever the services are and systems you put in place to, you know, manage it and potentially preserve it over time? And, you know, maybe if we ever realize this yes of open access, you know, some resources could be reallocated, you know, more specifically to support those kinds of initiatives. Yeah, that's one possibility I could imagine.
One of the burgeoning trends I've noticed on our campus too is that more and more researchers will invite librarians to be part of the team to develop the grant application. That has not happened, at least to my knowledge. We're seeing more and more of that, especially within the last year. We've seen an uptick in that area.
In fact, within just the last couple of weeks, the National Library of Medicine issued a request for application. I forget what they're calling it, but it is designed to provide salary support for a librarian to work specifically with an NIH-funded researcher. So,
They don't call it a librarian.
They call it an informationist.
Yeah,
that's a buzzword that came out of the medical library community, and I can tell you some stories about that. But actually, the term informationist is now being applied to indicate someone with a library background, but also some subject skills, so that they can integrate more closely into the research process. The NIH library, not National Library of Medicine, but the NIH library, which supports the clinical activities there, has moved all of their, what used to be reference librarians, into these informationist positions so that they've got more specialized training and can do exactly the kind of thing that Lorraine is talking about, really being part of the research team. So this funding initiative now from NLM is an add-on to an existing NIH research grant that the PI can then use to buy X number of hours of a librarian to work specifically on that project. And I would anticipate that NLM is going to start putting more money into this activity. So anyway, long answers to the question about open access. I don't think that any of us particularly see that as a threat.
You all answered very positively. You thought there was a very important role for you in an entirely open access role. But what I heard you saying in defining those roles, you're going to need still a fraction of that budget, which in this country is something like $3 billion that goes into subscriptions. And now, if that's sitting somewhere else in the university, how do we help you? How do we advocate that you deserve some fraction of that budget? Because your budgets have not tracked with the research budgets of your universities. You have not been an effective voice in getting the money you need. We'd like to help you do that.
That, I mean, that problem doesn't change in the same way as for any other non-revenue generating entity on the campus. One could argue, not that I'm doing that, but one could suggest that by taking on the kinds of roles that we're talking about here that are actually much more focused on solving the real problems that people are having at the institution, we're going to be better able to demonstrate the value that we bring and are going to be better advocates, not so much for infrastructure, depending on the institution. I don't need to have a bunch of servers in my library to help do data management. I need people. I need well-trained people. And if the money that I'm spending on collections gets turned around to help support publishing, I think it would be reasonable to have that continue to come through my organization. But if in a particular organization it makes sense to move that through a different entity, I've never seen that money as the library's money anyway. It's the institution's money.
I think part of the question, though, is about research overheads and that universities are not getting sufficient research overhead for research income, grant income. So I think it's a well-known and long-running problem that the overhead rates for extramural funded research don't equal the amount of money that the institution needs to actually support that research. So I think I was just looking at a recent report at UC that I think grant overhead supports about 75% of the cost of actually supporting a grant. So libraries are not going to be able to attract more of that grant overhead into their budgets. I mean, if that's kind of the thrust, I think, of your question, is how do we get more of the funding from the grant income into the library budget in order to support this? I think that's unfortunately a losing battle, and it's not really because libraries are not good advocates, it's because competition is intense across campus for research overhead funding, and it's folded into the institutional budget in different ways, and you're never really going to get that direct pipeline. It's just too complicated. But what we can do, and I think that's the trend now in open access funding, is to have that charge be part of the grant, so that rather than the institution trying to reclaim that as overhead and say, well, we need a larger share, that becomes a line item expenditure in the grant, and then the researchers have to make the decision about how to expend that money and that's also one of the areas where I think open access publication side funding begins to introduce a little bit more of a market dynamic into the publishing transaction, which is, I think we can all agree, somewhat dysfunctional today and part of the problem that we're struggling with. And it's researchers who will make decisions about how much to expend out of their grants to support publication, and that will exert more market pressure on those costs and on those fees, and then hopefully on the costs that of publication. So I think the route to capturing that income is not to get it through the institution in terms of grant overhead, but to actually build that into the grant itself as a charge.
Well said.
Yeah.
Hi, I'm Daniel Culp from the American Physical Society. This goes a little bit too with the librarians as advocates. Traditionally, in the scientific realm, advancement is still somewhat based on some traditional and archaic modes of thoughts, you know, high impact journals and things like that. Now, as the librarians move into more of a knowledge or information specialist or managers, do you find it within your role to educate or support deans and department heads and better understanding of what is important, and how do you judge the impact of, say, a researcher or a postdoc coming into a university? How do you help them judge to go away from just the traditional sort of blind, you know, let me look at your CV and what kind of publications you have? Do you see yourself in some sort of role in that arena?
If you're talking about reviews of cases, like tenure cases or promotion cases or job offer or, you know, fellowship offers. I know, and certainly at my institution, the library does not really have much direct influence or say in that. My boss sits on the tenure review group, you know, so she participates and sees those cases. And those are very rigorous cases that have gone, you know, kind of up the ladder as such. And certainly metrics around publications are a piece of that review. You know, we do educate our faculty and, you know, various administrators around, you know, variety of metrics that are out there and how to weigh them. But it's, you know, we try to contextualize it, and it's just a piece of, you know, what goes into any case. And so I don't know what it's like on the other campuses.
Yeah.
Well, I'm just going back to it. There's a lot of gray material out there, right? Unpublished material, data sets and stuff that you deal with. And I'm just wondering, because you handle it, if there's any role you play at help educating them as to how that goes into play. But, you know.
Not directly. I think very similar to what MIT does for us also. In the open access realm, we provide statistics of downloads and views from around the world. I mean, the citation thing they do on their own. That's about as much as we do. We do sit on the P&T review panels because our librarians have faculty status at KU. But, you know, the role is, there's a large group from the discipline and other areas who also have a role in that. So not so specifically and directly as you are asking.
I think it could become a growing area, though. I know there's a lot of interest in alt metrics in my organization, and we heard a great discussion presentation today about ways of aggregating some of that information to begin to build an alternative picture. I think part of the problem is that the alternatives haven't really been there. And so people have been talking for a long time about the fact that impact factor isn't really the be-all and end-all. It shouldn't rule and shouldn't govern, but you know, the weight of convenience and tradition is there. So I think as some of these newer methodologies begin to come into play, we will have more of a role, I think, in highlighting and surfacing those. So I think we're really at the beginning of that road.
Yeah, we've started to see, just I think in the last year, from some departments in the School of Medicine, it's clear that their P&T committees are really starting to look at those kinds of metrics. And so we're getting individual faculty members coming to us and saying, I need to get a better understanding of how these are calculated, where do I fit, how do I put this together, how do I present myself in the best way. So my librarians have actually been doing a lot of scrambling to educate ourselves to the point where we really understand this stuff well enough that we can provide guidance and provide some tutorials on how to use that. It's still all restricted to, you know, the traditional published literature. I haven't seen it moving into the kinds of great literature stuff you're talking about.
There is conversation, though, especially in the open access journals, because that's one that's the hot potato right now as to how do articles in open access journals count in the P&T world. And academia moves slowly when it comes to P&T issues, I'm afraid.
Hi, I'm Alicia Weiss from Elsevier, and I had a question. I think many of us will be aware that last week the Harvard Library Academic Advisory Committee issued a public statement, and I'd really welcome your thoughts on what librarians outside of Harvard are making of that, and what, if anything, constructive publishers could or should be doing in response. Thanks.
Well, maybe I'll go first since I'm just down the road, but
thanks, Steve.
I think when I saw that, I thought, oh, how interesting, you know, how late to the game, you know the Harvard is in terms of articulating these issues to the community in such a way. I think most of our institutions, you know, went through that you know, I don't know, a decade ago, or maybe, I don't know exactly the years, but maybe like in the, certainly by the mid-90s or so. And, you know, I always look at Ivy as a, maybe you can talk a little bit as a former member of the Harvard College Libraries or Harvard University
Libraries, right?
The which now is just one Harvard library as they go through their this huge reorganization there. But you know, Harvard is I've always looked at their library system as, you know, it's a one-off. It's as far as I know, it's probably the biggest library system in the world, and it's had the luxury up until just recently of not having to worry so much about and that's this is a gross oversimplification because I know when Ivy was there, she worried a lot about.
Thank you, Steve. I was going to have to correct you.
The increasing costs and things, but so I don't know. It was just kind of like we had some faculty, you know, kind of write us and go, "Gee, is this for real?" And you know, and it was like, "Yeah, you know, it's for real, and here are the reasons why." But it's kind of within the library community where I work at MIT, it was like kind of a non-event.
Not for us either. It was, where were they all these years? what they are experiencing, fuzzy memory for us now.
The one thing that bothers me about the discourse, though, is it's always the same commercial publishers that are being called out. And I really think that we've got to look at the sum of the societies as well. We've got to admit that there's an endemic problem kind of in the publishing world across the board. It's not just the for-profit communities that are causing this pressure that we're faced with. We're also looking at a lot of the society publications too, that are adding just as much pressure, if not more so, in certain subject areas. And it always really kind of runs afoul with me a little bit that we're like kind of pointing out the big guys in the room, but not admitting that there's this sort of endemic problem across the board.
Yeah, I think that the flip side to that, and I think what bothers me about some of Not so much the Harvard statement itself as the pieces that have appeared in the general press about it, which present a certain set of facts as if they are representative of all of STM publishing. And they're just not. You've got this very, very long tail of small publishers that have tried very hard to have reasonable subscription prices and be good citizens and all, who I think are much more vulnerable than the big publishers. And I agree that there's, you know, as the old line about not-for-profit is a tax status, it's not a business plan. So I think because librarians tend to focus on the publishers who create the biggest problem for us in terms of pricing and in terms of trying to be able to afford everything, we lose sight of that long tail of other publishers for whom those statistics about margins and prices and all are just not accurate in any way. And what I fear is that focus, because it misrepresents the industry as a whole, endangers a really broad-based publishing industry, which I think we need. I've had a couple of conversations with people recently that I would love to see an organization like STM or AAP or whatever develop a better set of statistics that more clearly represents the totality of STM publishing, so that we have better data and don't always end up ourselves being drawn towards the couple of really high-profile publishers. And so I think the Harvard letter itself may not have been a problem, but I think some of the general press that has come out of that has not been helpful.
But it does become a self-perpetuating cycle because you tend to focus where the money is,
right.
And the big money is in the big deal.
Right.
And so societies have increasingly been going to the larger publishers because they can. They see that as a path to sustainability.
Right.
We say that's a problem, but then we as librarians say that's a problem, but then we as librarians are focusing our efforts where we're writing that big check. And
right.
So in a way, we're perpetuating that cycle. I think one of the things that the Harvard statement was trying to suggest and call attention to is that we libraries have to take some action that may, in some respects, be against our interests as information providers to our communities in stepping away from those deals in order to break that cycle. And there were some suggestions there that we may have to step away from some of these deals in order to try and introduce a more balanced marketplace, and that may create some pain. And so, dear faculty members, go think about how else you might think about publishing, because we're probably going to try and cause some pain, or we're going to find ourselves having to cause some pain in order to deal with the sustainability issues. I mean, I'm someone who's referred to some of the STM publications and articulations of the stresses on publishing as being structural stresses, and I think STM as an organization and some of its published reports and commission reports has done a good job of highlighting the growth in publication and how that tracks with research funding and with growth of researchers. And it's really a structural problem. We have that decline of library budgets in institutions, and we have that increase in research publication over time. And that's a big part of the sustainability problem. Acknowledging it as a structural problem doesn't absolve any of us from solving it. It means we have to solve it, and we have to solve it by bringing down the unit cost of that publishing so that it can be sustained. I think that's certainly my perspective and the perspective of my institution. If you look at unit cost, you can see some really large disparities between what some open access publishers are able to achieve and what some other costs are in the marketplace. So how can we bring down those unit costs in some way that makes the system more sustainable?
Michael is desperate to get his hands on it. All right.
I'm taking this in a slightly different direction. We've been talking a lot about resources for researchers, and I'm curious about your role in educating new students and undergraduates to the services of the libraries. We hear a lot that students use Google and Wikipedia for their research reports, but there's so many other tools that have a lot of integrity. So how do you go about orienting them to those tools and helping them find the haystack-sized piles of needles that are out there, and also how do you orient them to new tools if they're evolving?
So we have dedicated librarians who work with the incoming freshmen. We have just appointed our first year experienced librarian at KU. There are several others around the country to work specifically with incoming students. But with the general undergraduate student population, our library, like most libraries, has a whole division of instructional librarians. Like most libraries, have done the one-shot instruction sessions, first semester, second semester, which in my mind is not very effective. I think the students are overwhelmed, and maybe a better time would be to get into their sophomore year so that they can stick. The one-shot deal to me is not scalable. We don't have enough librarians. We see thousands of students in that way, but it's at one shot. And for many, it doesn't come until much later. Transfer students who are not there in their freshmen don't get that almost until graduation. So it's a wasted effort for them, because what they could have learned, they've lost. And when they're graduating is when they find out what they should have known when they first came on board. Our university is now working on redrafting, the general education core curriculum. And the librarians will be embedded in that process. We have an instructional design librarian, and we have several instructional librarians who will increasingly work with faculty in the curriculum design as well as in the course design of the delivery, so that they are in the classroom. And beyond that, because that's not too scalable either, University of Arizona has almost all of their tutorials online so that, you know, students can help themselves at their own pace and so on, as long as they complete some of those tutorials to help them. But that's how we will begin to work much more closely with faculty who often see librarians as taking time from their classes. And so embedding them in this way is a much more, hopefully, productive way of collaborating with faculty and introducing some of the resources, but also the learning outcomes. You know, sharing the definition of what the learning outcome is so that they can work together in achieving those.
Yeah, we're also working very closely with our Center for Online Learning. We're an urban campus, but we also teach a tremendous number of classes online. And we have one program in particular, a criminology program, which is can be opted into as a complete online offering as an undergraduate. And we work very closely with the online learning faculty to make sure that the library is a part of that. We're in our learning management system as a direct link. So anytime a course is created in there, there's links that they can click and get into to chat to a librarian as part of the course offering. We also have been doing our own online modules on Mendeley, on Zotero, on different resources that libraries can that students can use readily, that they don't have to pay for, they don't have to go through any paywalls, and that are a bit easier to use, that are just extensions on browsers. So we're feeling pretty confident. We're also we don't have a first year experience librarian, but we do have a distance education librarian who does a lot of the general education and especially works very closely with the online learning community to develop those programs. And we have a credit offering now that I think it's a one credit course that also goes towards supporting that sort of education.
Yeah, I think again, similar things. One of the ways that I like to look at it is it used to be that all of the most important work of a librarian happened inside the library building. And the library building is still very important. And we spend a lot of time trying to, you know, rethink how the space is used and make it a vital space. But the most important work of the librarians now happens outside the building. And some of that is electronically in the ways we've talked about. Some of it is getting outside. I have librarians who do office hours a couple of times a week in student lounges in the different schools, just partly just building relationships. We have modules with inside the course management system where the librarian is really sitting in the online class space along with the faculty member. So I think all of these different kinds of strategies are ways that we're attempting to address that issue.
I'd like to say something about the premise of the question, though. I think the premise of the question was students are using Google and Wikipedia, and those aren't really vetted sources. And how do you bring them to, you know, to help them use better sources? And I'm not sure that that's really what's true anymore. I was very impressed by a presentation of a study at SSP a couple of years ago that was done at Berkeley, giving a research question to a librarian, a student, and a faculty member, same question, and asking them to go answer it and then evaluating the results. Librarian used all of the traditional indexes and, you know, what a librarian would think of to use, right? The student went, I don't remember the student and faculty member, I think, both went to Google and probably did something in different ways. The moral of the story was that the librarian was the one who did not come up with the answer. And the student and the faculty member, using non-traditional tools, came up with the answer. Now, it was a particular research question that actually was well served by internet resources, and there's some other kinds of questions that might not be. But I think the message there is that the world of information really is changing. You know, when in the early days of Wikipedia, everyone was writing about, was Wikipedia really a reliable source, and comparing Britannica to Wikipedia. And I think we can see who's won in a way. It's not true that Wikipedia is not a reliable source. So I think we have to think about that question very, very differently. All of us in libraries are seeing the use of our indexing and abstracting tools decline. And we're not sure what that means. We're not sure if, you know, changes in counter statistics play a role there. Are things being counted differently this year than they were last year? As great, as wonderful as counter is, it's also changing things iteratively in ways that make it hard to compare data, even though it's introduced more of a baseline of comparability than before. But I think we're all trying to understand whether and to what degree we should be continuing to invest in these traditional resources that may be, in fact, delivering less and less value over time. So it's really a different world on many different levels.
I thought it was interesting this morning when Sid was giving his presentation and talking about discovery services, and he put up the slide that showed, you know, some of the products that are being developed and marketed. He didn't list Google Scholar on that slide, and I was talking to him about it afterwards, and because I know on my campus, Google Scholar is used a lot, and we register our resources with Google, so you know you can get to the content, you know, if you're going through and have actually registered. So I think to go back to the question though, in terms of instruction to undergraduates, I think we try to employ many of the things that have already been spoken to, and I think a lot of it is really just trying to market the library as a helpful place, you know, and on many dimensions, as well as building relationships with key individuals and key faculty in particular. One thing that did one of our biggest successes over the last half dozen years or so was partnering with a faculty member who teaches one of our chemistry core freshman courses. You know, over half the freshman class takes this course every year, and integrating in, he was a strong believer in good scholarly information and kind of trying to, you know, train the students young about, you know, its value. So integrating in actual exercises, you know, supervised by him, but with, you know, input and authoring by us, so to speak, has been successful. And also trying to think about other existing requirements. At MIT, there's a communications requirement that is quite rigorous, and trying to partner with those particular classes when appropriate to embed good information seeking and use skills has been an effective strategy.
I wanted to add here also, one of the best ways probably to market library and tools and expertise and so on are the kind of spaces we develop for them to come to. Library as place has probably become the most important thing about libraries anymore. While the circulation stats are going down, the library traffic stats are going this way. So I think the kind of spaces to get them into the library has had a huge impact on the way we think about library as place. What we don't do very well as librarians, I think, is we have them all by the thousands in there, but we don't get to them all and engage them in very effective ways. They come in there mostly because we have peer-to-peer programs where they talk to each other, and we train some of the peers, senior students, to work directly with students. They seem to like that. But to offer the spaces, the group study spaces, but also reflective spaces for those who desire those kind of spaces inside the library buildings. It's amazing what small improvements can do to enhance the learning experience of students, especially undergraduates, but not forgetting our graduate students as well.
So I'd like to go back to the Harvard letter and also tie it to Fred's thought experiment. So reading the Harvard letter here, those of you who haven't read it, it's definitely worth reading. So you talk about Harvard's annual cost for journals from these providers, meaning the big commercial publishers, now approaches $3.75 million, which is about 20% of the periodical subscription budget for Harvard. So I did the math. this is, even the full subscription budget, not just this $3.75 million, is less than half of 1% of Harvard's annual budget. So we're talking about a rounding error here. So this to me doesn't seem like a problem. For Harvard, it might be a problem for other organizations, but for Harvard, this isn't a problem. It might be a problem of priority, but it's not a real, it's not a budgetary problem. And if all of these articles were published via open access, I went to Web of Science and looked up how many articles were published by Harvard faculty last year, and it was something in the order of 13,500. You multiply that by 1,000, let's call it $1,500 or whatever. We're looking at, you know, $22 million, which is a lot more. Not, you know, still a rounding error for Harvard, but more money. And so you might make the case. Harvard might make the case that, well, okay, yeah, we might want to spend more money and go the open access route because it gives us more, more accessibility to the content that our faculty publish, but it's going to cost more. And that's okay, but it doesn't seem like we're talking about a budget problem here. It seems like we're talking about something else. And I'd like to tie it back to Fred's point earlier as well, in sort of thinking through these different thought scenarios. And I think one of the other important factors here is that journals are not for dissemination of information. I think anybody agrees that you can just go, you can post your PDF on the website, on a website, on a blog, tomorrow. And if that's all that journals were doing, you know, that wouldn't, you know, it wouldn't really be an issue. Of course, the unit cost for journal publishing would go down to something like zero, but really it's for designation. It's for figuring out which faculty get grants, which faculty get promoted, which faculty get career advancement, and so forth, and providing a filtration function for users, and so forth. And I don't know that an open access model has yet proven that it can replicate those functions. It may, over time. But it also may be that more second-level services need to come into play in an open access world, and my guess is that those second-level services are not going to be free or possibly even cheap. So to me, this doesn't seem like a question of money. Or of raw budget. It seems to be a question of institutional priority. And I'm just wondering to what extent these discussions are happening at your universities and to what extent the library has a seat at the table.
There are many things in your statements that I agree with. I think the priority problem is a problem. I was very early in my library career when I was trying to figure out the politics of the institution I was at, and the senior administrator that I was talking to said, there's always money, and the question is what does it get spent on? And I think in library land, we have been trying for at least 20 years to come up with really compelling metrics for demonstrating the actual impact that we have on the priorities of the institution, and we simply have not done a good job with that. So one of the things that I'm doing through this budget cycle in a very, very small scale is I'm going around and I'm talking to the deans and I'm talking to the department chairs, and we've got a little project going where we are asking the key researchers in each of the priority research areas, what do you see as the key resources that support your research area? And we're going to start mapping our collecting to that. So there's a level of engagement with our research community that we're trying to improve upon that should get us better information. But it's the competing, you know, the provost is going to have, you know, 10x good ideas and 3x of money. And the things that have a clearly demonstrated value to the priorities of the institution are going to get the funding. And that is a serious problem for libraries that we have not resolved.
So, like Scott, I think there's a lot in what you've said that I would also agree. I know at my institution, you know, the budget, you know, basically breaks down into research sponsorship and what's called the general institute budget. And then, of course, there's the endowment, you know, which in a sense subsidizes the general institute budget mostly. And it's out of the what we call the GID that library is funded, and overhead, you know, coming in from the research program gets funneled into the GID in that way. And as Ivy said, we're under recovering on the research side. So that's a major problem. And as Scott indicated, the provost has X, there's 10 times X demand, you know, on that. And they look at library budgets, and they particularly look at acquisition budgets, collection budgets, and they see this line that goes up at a rate that's higher than inflation, that it has typically, you know, over the long term, that, you know, every year is eating up, you know, maybe, you know, 25% or, you know, give or take in any direction, the total available new money they have to allocate, you know, to whatever new initiatives are important for the university. So it's you've got kind of a marketing problem there, you know, in terms of how it's perceived as just this insatiable cost.
So I'll just take a crack also at your comment. So I don't think any of us really know what's underneath those Harvard numbers, so I'm itching to find out, because clearly there's some oddities there in the numbers that they were putting forward. But I think even in that Harvard statement, I think in the preamble there's something that says that, you know, that we're suffering from two problems, and one is about affordability and the other is about restrictions on access and use or something. And I think those are the dual issues that we're often confronting when we're talking about how to transform the research publishing enterprise in a way that will support the kind of advancements in research and collaboration that open access does allow and digital technologies do allow, but the current subscription regime, by virtue of the way it works economically, you know, places a lot of barriers on. So it's a combination of the budgetary pressures and the desire to publish in a new way to support research advances in research in a new way. In terms of the question about shifting cost to the research-intensive institutions, I think was another. You did some analysis of the publishing rates at Harvard and what the cost would be if they were funding open access in a different way. We've done a lot of analysis of that in my organization as well, and so we have a pretty good sense of what we're spending now, what we would be spending if we were fully supporting author payment, article processing fees for our authors at various levels of cost, and what that would look like if research funding were tapped to fund some percentage of those. And I think, to me, the answer of how to get to a lower expenditure to bring to a return to the unit cost question, to introduce or to achieve affordability and sustainability, we have to bring more research funding into the mix, and we also have to lower the unit cost of publication somehow. And we've done analyses in my organization, for example, our own e-scholarship publishing unit, $9 per article or unit of publication in that repository. Now, that's not all of the cost of publication, because we don't do peer review. That's done by the groups that use our services and use our platforms. So some of that is happening outside of the system. But $9 an article, I think for archive, the unit cost is something like $6 an article. We have to get a lot closer to those levels than $3,000 an article or even $1,500 an article in order to achieve that sustainability and yet support a more open environment. And research funding is going to need to be part of the mix, but unit cost, reducing unit costs also should be part of the mix. So I think, you know, the Harvard article didn't really talk about all of those things, but I think those are those are some of the drivers for that desire to be impactful in promoting change in a significant and potentially disruptive way.
Question all the way in the back.
Oh, Hi, Dan Tonkrey. One of the questions that I always have, and you know, I've been in both sides of the world. I've worked in libraries. I've worked in for corporations. One of the problems that libraries have that made the transition, if you look at your budgets, 80%, some high percent of your acquisitions budget goes to support electronic materials. You still have, every one of you still has an enormous amount of staff doing print, low priority. I mean, there's an army of people that you haven't been able to find a way to trade in, for a better term. And so I think that, you know, it's unfair to blame the publishers on all the problems, you know, because of high prices or price increase, when all of you probably are sitting on 60% of your budget. If you were in a commercial entity, would have already cashed that in. That's one thought. So how do you see cashing that in is one question. And the second question, Ivy, you worked at Harvard. You know that Harvard is probably, if not the most dysfunctional library organized in America, it's second only to the Library of Congress. So, you know, there's millions of dollars trapped in just total dysfunction. And you know, and before you ask for, you know, a bailout from the publishers, it seems to me that somewhere along the line, libraries ought to step to the plate and say, you know, we really need to do something with some of our assets who are sitting on their assets.
In principle, I agree with that. In reality, I think the situation is not as dire as you present. Transitioning organizations is something that I suspect we are all dealing with. And by that, I mean everybody in this room. Every publisher who set up their processes and services and systems and people to deal with print is now having to make that same transition. In my case, now I'm a biomedical library, so it's a little bit easier for me than for some of my colleagues. We are 100% of our spend goes to electronic, and I have made serious personnel changes, and I can assure you that there are no remaining unused assets in my library. And I think we could find additional examples of that. So certainly the issue, libraries becoming more efficient is an ongoing necessity. But I'm not sure the reality is quite the way that you paint it.
Let me just say one thing. You know, I play golf. And for 15 years, I played golf with a group of ARL directors. And I can tell you, after about the third Jack Daniels, they all could come up with $3, $5, $7 million of savings in their institution if it was politically correct to do, or there weren't union problems. I mean, really serious money is still locked up in many institutions that they can't touch, and they would do it in a heartbeat. And you know, the library in Kansas is up there. I know many of your colleagues off the record would tell you that, you know, life could be different if you know, you took away all the regulations and rules and things in many of your institutions. And I may be overstating the case, but I just think that there's that somewhere along the line, you know, you don't, I mean, how many catalogers have to catalog? Every one of you doing the same thing across the country, and you've never been able to get out of that yet.
Well, okay. Who wants to go first? All right, so the Orbis Cascade Alliance is looking at exactly this problem and this issue, and we are moving towards a shared integrated library system among 37 librarians, or 37 libraries. And let me tell you, this is not going to be an easy task for 37 libraries to basically share all the processing, technical processing of all our resources that are held individually but also collectively within the alliance. And part and parcel of going forward with the shared integrated library system is that we will go into what's being called collaborative technical services, with the idea being that there will be 1 to 3 institutions that will be basically doing monographic cataloging. There'll be 1 to 3 institutions that will do electronic resource management. How this is really going to work in reality, when we are all very contextualized to our own individual researchers and our own individual identities, is going to be really interesting. And I'm not sure, you know, there's a lot of apprehension among all the institutions about this, because can this really be pulled off? And I know CDL has done some centralized, or the California schools have looked at doing some centralized processing. And it really becomes really hard, I think, because there is this focus to try to support the individual research needs that are going on at the institutions. And how can you do that and still not have that specialized service in place that you've had historically?
Yeah, but I think those kinds of experiments are, we're going to be seeing more of that. Columbia and Cornell have just entered into a partnership and are looking for other institutions to participate. And it's a recognition of the rather exaggerated way in which Dan frames the issue, but clearly the fact that in this very networked world, each of us in our institutions doing the same thing for our local institution, when we really have the potential for getting some really serious economies of scale. But as Jill says, at the same time, we want to make sure that we do this in ways that still allow us to meet the specific needs of our particular communities. So it's unknown territory, and it requires a certain amount of balancing to get there. But I think that kind of experimentation is one of the most exciting things that I've seen coming out of library land in the last year.
I just wanted, since you touched on the rules and regulations of Kansas. So there are rules and regulations that prohibit us from moving and doing stuff about staff in particular. But as many others, I'm fully committed. We're actually doing a strategic planning process that will deliver a strategic plan this summer, whereby we will look very closely at areas of duplication within our own library, not even across, and to realign, to find the strength and the expertise of people, support them in training and so on, so we can, you know, realign them in different ways. They may not go away, but they may not do the same thing that they've always done before. That's one way to at least redeploy the expertise in new and exciting areas that we do want to pursue.
I would agree it's very political, and that just kind of remind the audience that, you know, we're up here representing academia, which, you know, is probably, you know, the church is the only institution that's more traditional, you know. So the kind of change you speak to, you know, is very rational and logical, but it's not an easy path getting there because of the governance issues and political issues of all the constituencies we deal with locally.
Well, also, if you look at all of the budget cuts that have happened in libraries, particularly in academic libraries over the last several years, most libraries have done what they can to protect their collections budgets, believe it or not. And even though those collection budgets have also been cut, there have been much deeper cuts in other areas. So you've had libraries closing. You have these shared technical services initiatives, which are legion. I don't know of any institution that isn't engaged in one. So these are long-range efforts, and will take a while for that kind of reshaping of the footprint. There are also a lot of efforts to reshape the footprint of print collections in libraries, which, Dan, you were talking about. Those are enormous legacy collections, and it's not easy to transform them overnight, particularly when you have humanities faculty who say, don't throw out our books. So there, it's a complicated issue to transform that footprint, but there are many initiatives to do just that, and I think those initiatives will take time. But a lot of the reductions in libraries have come exactly in those operational areas.
And your comment, though, does raise, I think, an important issue, and that is the perception is, I think, very much often what you've articulated, and that's a problem, I think, that we all face up here in terms of the value proposition about what we're doing and how we are trying to transform and in ways that are productive in support of faculty and students.
We're coming near the end of our time, and I know that Lorraine has a plane to catch.
Back to Kansas, no.
is there one more burning question from anybody, or are we ready to? Oh, we've got, Fred has one more.
I'm sure it'll be a short one.
Right, something we can address in just a couple of minutes.
This is for Ivy, because you quoted a number, and that is the cost of archive processing an article. It's like $7 or $9. They're very proud of that. Okay. And I hope you know, as a librarian, that publishers do a lot more than what the archive does. I'm a physicist. I use the archive. We're very proud of the archive. But I could sit here in 5 minutes, because they know me, and I could write an article, and it'll be posted on the archive. But what I do as a modest physics publisher to publish 15,000 articles, I have to manage 140 editors that I pay for. I buy down your academic time to do that job, and I manage about 50,000 reviews. That costs money, and that costs about 25% of what we charge for the final article. When you add all the rest, it's a lot more than $9. So stop using the archive analogy.
I also used our e-scholarship service, which does publish journals. We publish about 40 journals, some of which are quite well regarded. And we do not handle the peer review. We provide the technology platform and services, and the publishing groups perform their own peer review and manage that process. We provide back-end tools. That's the $9 cost, but it does not include the cost of peer review. What I was really trying to highlight was the delta, though, between, you know, if you look at the Research Information Network studies of a few years ago that talked about $4,000 per article, many publishers that are charging $3,000 to $5,000 or even $10,000 or more per article say that that's to recover the cost of publishing mm-hmm. an article, you know, across their platform. Somehow, we have to be able to get from $3,000 to $5,000 to $10,000 and $9, there's got to be something in the middle. Even $1,500 may be too high. I think, you know, we heard this morning from David Lippman, who was made an argument that I hadn't, or a case that I hadn't heard before about the problems with peer review, the things that peer review doesn't actually address and solve that are really important to the value of the scientific enterprise and the outcome of the scientific enterprise. And I think the argument there was for much lighter peer review, because peer review, as it's commonly conceived, doesn't really do the full job that it's conceived of to do, or that it's considered to do. Now, that doesn't address the filtering question. I mean, I realize that there are many complex functions that are embedded in the system, which is why it's very hard to transform. And I agree that we need collaboration to solve those issues. It's not, but there's a wide gap there between what is presumed to be the cost and what can be the cost under potentially a more lightweight, leaner system. And somehow we're going to have to get from somewhere. We're going to have to find a way forward, or less information is going to be published.
And I'm going to call it there. although we could keep going, I'm sure. I want to thank all of you very much for participating. I hope this has been useful to you. Thanks to the panelists. And I guess we now have a 30-minute break. Is that correct?
Yes.
Yes.
In the back room for research.
All right. Thank you.